Okay, so this video is just a continuation of the previous video, okay, where we started the lower limb. So we looked at the pelvic region, the three bones that form the pelvic bone, which is the ilium, ischium, and the pubis. Okay, two hip bones come together, the sacrum, the coccyx, to form the pelvic region or the pelvic bones. Okay, so we looked at the anterior thigh muscles, which are 6. Some books don't say 8. Okay, so let me start with the 6 ones. We looked at the iliopsoas muscle, which is made up of the iliacus and the psoas muscle. We looked at the sartorius muscle, the longest muscle in the human body. We looked at the quadriceps muscles, which are 4. So those two, the iliopsoas, sartorius, and the 4 quadriceps, there are 6. So the quadriceps, you have the rectus femoris, you have the vastus lateralis, you have the vastus intermedius, you have the vastus medialis. Okay, so there are 6. Then you have 2 other muscles, the pectineus and the tensor fascia lata, that are also found in other compartments. For example, the tensor fascia lata is also found in the gluteal region, one we'll look at. And the pectineus muscles is also found in the medial compartment. Okay, so you can say there are 6. True muscles are 6. You also have those 2, so 8. Then we also looked at the medial compartment, which has 6 muscles. Okay, where you have the same pectineus, the adductor longus, adductor brevis, adductor magnus, the obturator externus, and the gracilis. Okay, so those 6 muscles are found in the major compartment. So now, for this video, we are going to look at the gluteal region, the structures found there. We'll look at the posterior thigh, and we'll look at the popliteal fossa. Then for the next vision, we have to conclude on the thigh and the pelvic region. So we'll look at the ligaments of the hip joint. Then we'll look at the ligaments of the knee joint, because from the thigh, we are going to the leg. So before you go to the leg, you need to look at the knee joint, basically itself. Also have to know the lumbosacral plexus. That's basically the innervation, pelvic region and to the lower limb. Yeah, basically, you have the common iliac artery. Those are branches from the abdominal aorta will terminate into 2 common iliac arteries, the left common iliac artery and the right common iliac artery. And those common iliac arteries, they divide again to form the external iliac artery and the internal iliac artery. So the external iliac artery is the one that will continue as the femoral artery. The femoral artery is going to continue as the popliteal artery. You're going down. So then the internal iliac basically will supply the pelvic region there. You even have this artery in your lumbar artery. You have other arteries coming from the internal iliac arteries, which you need to know. Okay, because the internal iliac artery basically supplies the pelvic region. Then the lumbosacral plexus will look at it. Okay. Basically, all the nerves, the femoral nerve we've been talking about, the obturator nerve, the superior gluteal nerve we'll talk about today, and the inferior gluteal nerve. We'll also talk about the sciatic nerve that is made up of the common fibular nerve and the tibial nerve. So these two, they'll come together to form the sciatic nerve, the thickest nerve in the human body. As you can see, it's very thick and big. So the gluteal region. So when it comes to the gluteal region, gluteus means buttock. Okay, so it lies on the posterior aspect of the pelvis. And it is the most superior part of the lower limb. So the gluteal region contains muscles that extends, abducts, and laterally rotate the thigh. Although there will be some few muscles that will medially rotate the thigh, but the gluteal region is specialized basically for these functions. Bring about extension of the thigh, abduction, and lateral rotation of the thigh. So let's revise a bit. We looked at the gluteal surface of the ilium. We said the ilium has three surfaces. That is the iliac fossa on the anterior aspect, which you cannot see. You have the gluteal surface, and you have the sacropelvic surface. So it has three surfaces. So now, since we're looking at the gluteal region, so you need to revise, you need to know more about the gluteal surface, the ilium. Okay, so when it comes to the ilium, said on the gluteal surface, it has three lines, which you need to know. So you have the posterior gluteal line, which originates from the iliac crest, approximately 5 centimeters from the posterior superior iliac spine. So approximately 5 centimeters from the posterior superior iliac spine, you have the posterior gluteal line, and it goes to the posterior superior iliac spine. So it is coming from the iliac crest to the posterior superior iliac spine. Then you have the anterior gluteal line. So the anterior gluteal line comes from the greater sciatic notch. It is the longest of the three lines. From the greater sciatic notch, it goes all the way to the iliac crest, the outer lip of the iliac crest. The iliac crest has the outer lip, has the intermediate lip, has the medial lip. So it is coming from the greater sciatic notch to the outer lip of the iliac crest. Then the last one is the inferior gluteal line. So the inferior gluteal line comes from the anterior inferior iliac spine. So even on the anterior aspect, you're going to have the anterior superior iliac spine, and you're going to have the anterior inferior iliac spine, just as we have the posterior superior iliac spine and the posterior inferior iliac spine. So even on the anterior aspect, you're going to have the anterior inferior iliac spine. So that's where the inferior gluteal line is going to originate from. Then it is going to go to the greater sciatic notch. Then you have that ligament there, the sacrotuberous ligaments. Although we'll talk about these ligaments more when we look at the ligaments that form the hip joint. So for the sacrotuberous ligament, it is coming from the posterior aspect of the sacrum, going to the ischial tuberosity. Okay, so we'll talk about the gluteus maximus, which also originates from the sacrotuberous ligament. You also have another ligament, the sacrospinous ligament, from the sacrum to the ischial spine. So basically, know those lines, know the gluteal tuberosity on the posterior aspect of the femur, where the gluteus maximus comes to insert, and you have the pectineal line on the medial aspect of the posterior femur. So these two, they'll come together to form the linea aspera. Then you're going to have the quadrate tubercle. Also, between the greater trochanter and the lesser trochanter on the posterior aspect, you have the intertrochanteric crest. Then on the superior aspect of the intertrochanteric crest, you have a car elevation that is quadrangular. So normally it is known as quadrate tubercle. So you have the muscle, we'll talk about the muscle that will come to insert here. Okay. So quadrate tubercle on the posterior aspect of the femur. Okay. So know those thing. So when it comes to the gluteal region, the first muscle we'll look at will be the gluteus maximus. Okay, gluteus, very famous muscle where you inject. Okay, this is where you introduce an injection, the gluteus maximus, and you need to know where exactly are you supposed to introduce that injection. So it has to be, so for example, this is the gluteus maximus. You can even divide it into four quadrants. That's a gluteus maximus. You can divide it into four quadrants. So the injection has to be introduced on the upper outer quadrant, this one, this quadrant here. And we'll talk about why you should not introduce the needle there, you should not introduce the needle there, and you should not introduce the needle there, because you can easily damage the neurovascular structures there. So there you rarely have neurovascular structures, but there, if it's those two, you even have the sciatic nerve, you know, the same thickest nerve there. So now imagine you introduce an injection into the sciatic nerve. So it can cause paralysis to the entire lower limb.
So the gluteus maximus originates from the ilium. You remember the posterior gluteal line, right? So now the gluteus maximus is going to originate posterior to the posterior gluteal line. Okay, so you have, for example, that is the posterior gluteal line there. The gluteus maximus is going to originate from the posterior aspect of the posterior gluteal line, so somewhere there. Okay, then it also originates from the dorsal surface of the sacrum and coccyx. And lastly, it will originate from the sacrotuberous ligament, from the dorsal aspect of the sacrum to the ischial spine, that ligament there. It will also originate from there. Then it goes to inserts into the iliotibial tract. So that's the iliotibial tract there. So it will go to insert into the iliotibial tract and the gluteal tuberosity of the posterior femur. Yeah. So the innervation is via the inferior gluteal nerve. Then for the action, it will bring about extension and lateral rotation of the thigh. The next one, so when you remove the gluteus maximus, you cut it off, the next muscle you'll see will be the gluteus medius. So that muscle there is the gluteus medius. You remove the gluteus maximus. Okay. So it originates from the external surface of the ilium between the anterior and posterior gluteal line. So you have the posterior gluteal line and you have the anterior gluteal line in between there, that surface. That is where this muscle is going to originate from. Okay. And also from gluteal fascia. So gluteal fascia is basically the deep fascia of the gluteal region. Okay. Then the insertion, it inserts on the lateral surface of the greater trochanter of the femur. Innervation is via the superior gluteal nerve, and for the action, it brings about abduction and medial rotation of the thigh. As you can see, even though we said the gluteal region is specialized in lateral rotation of the thigh, you have this muscle, the gluteus medius, that will bring about medial rotation of the thigh. Then you have the gluteus minimus, just by the name of the smallest among of the three gluteus muscles. So the gluteus minimus originates from the lateral surface of the ilium between the anterior and inferior gluteal line. So you have the anterior gluteal line, you have the inferior gluteal line. The region, the surface there in between, that's where the gluteus minimus is going to originate from. Then insertion, it inserts on the anterior surface of the greater trochanter of the femur. Then the innervation, it is via the superior gluteal nerve. The action to bring about abduction and medial rotation of the thigh. Okay, that's the gluteus minimus. And you have the tensor fascia lata. Tensor fascia lata, I already talked about this when we were looking at the anterior thigh. So the tensor fascia lata originates from the anterior superior iliac spine and it inserts into the iliotibial tract. So that whitish thin, white band, which is just thickening of the fascia lata, which is the deep fascia of the thigh. So the fascia lata thickens on the lateral aspect of the thigh to form the iliotibial tract. Then on the superiormost part, you're going to have the muscle, which is known as the tensor fascia lata. So it will originate from the anterior superior iliac spine, then it inserts into the same iliotibial tract. Then innervation is via the superior gluteal nerve. For the actions to bring about abduction, medial rotation of the thigh, and as well as flexion of the thigh. When it was added, the flexor compartment or the anterior thigh. Then you have the piriformis. When it comes to the piriformis, to originate from the anterior surface of the sacrum. So that muscle there is the piriformis. So it originates from the anterior surface. So the surface you can see here is the posterior surface. So that muscle will go to the anterior aspect. So it will originate from the anterior surface of the sacrum. Then it will go to insert on the greater trochanter of the femur on the lateral side. So that muscle there is the piriformis. Then the innervation is via the anterior rami of C1 and C2. Then for the action, it laterally rotates the thigh, as you can tell. So when this contracts, the thigh is going to rotate like that. So that's lateral rotation of the thigh. Okay. So the next muscle we'll look at is the obturator internus. So the obturator internus, just by the name internus, so it will originate from the internal aspect. Right? So it will originate from the internal margin of the obturator foramen. So you have the obturator foramen, which has the external margin where the obturator externus muscle originates from, and the internal margin where the obturator internus is originating from. And it will also originate from the inner surface of the obturator membrane. Okay. In the insertion, it inserts on the greater trochanter of the femur on the lateral side. The innervation is via the nerve to the obturator internus, and the action to bring about lateral rotation of the femur. So the next muscle is the superior gemellus. So it comes to this muscle, the superior gemellus. So this muscle will originate from the ischial spine. Okay, you remember the ischial spine, right? Where you have the sacrospinous ligament, from the sacrum to the ischial spine. So that's the ischial spine. You have the superior gemellus that is originating from it. Okay, so the superior gemellus is that one. So you have those muscles. So you have the piriformis. After the piriformis, lower to the piriformis, you're going to have the superior gemellus, which originates from the ischial spine and inserts on the greater trochanter of the femur. And also, it also inserts into the tendon for the obturator internus. So this is the obturator internus, which we'll talk about. So this same superior gemellus will insert on the greater trochanter as well as the tendon for the obturator internus. Then innervation is via the nerve to the obturator internus. And for the action, it will bring about lateral rotation of the femur or thigh, basically. So then the next muscle is the inferior gemellus. So when it comes to the inferior gemellus, it originates from the ischial tuberosity. Okay, so that's the inferior gemellus originating from the ischial tuberosity, which is that thin. It goes to insert on the greater trochanter of the femur. And also, it will also insert in the tendon for the obturator internus muscle. When it comes to the innervation, it is innervated by the nerve to the quadratus femoris. So that muscle there, we'll talk about it, quadratus femoris. The nerve supply to that muscle will also supply the inferior gemellus. Then our next muscle is obturators femoris. So that, or quadratus femoris. So quadratus femoris, just by the name itself. So it will originate from the ischial tuberosity. As you can see, that's the ischial tuberosity. It will originate from the ischial tuberosity. Then it goes to insert on the quadrate tubercle of the posterior femur. So they are on the intertrochanteric crest of the femur, you have the quadrate tubercle on the superiormost aspect. So from that same quadrate tubercle, that's where this muscle is going to insert. Innervation is via the quadratus, nerve to the quadratus femoris, and action is to bring about lateral rotation of the thigh. So that diagram just illustrates basically all the muscles we talked about. So this is the gluteus maximus, which has been reflected. Then you have the gluteus medius. After the gluteus medius, which has also been reflected, you have the gluteus minimus. So inferior to the gluteus minimus, you have the piriformis, that muscle there. The piriformis is very important, and is you can easily identify the piriformis because on top of the piriformis, you have nerves and blood vessels which will appear. And inferior to the piriformis, again, you're going to have nerves and blood vessels that will appear. Okay, so that's how you can identify the piriformis. So look at the muscle. So for you to locate the piriformis, look at the muscle that has nerves and blood vessels on the upper border and the lower border. Okay, so the nerve and the blood vessel that will appear on the superior border of the piriformis will be known as the superior gluteal artery and nerve. So that will be the superior gluteal artery or the superior gluteal nerve that will innervate the gluteus, medius, gluteus, minimus, and the tensor fascia lata. And you're going to have the superior gluteal artery, okay, a branch from the internal iliac artery. Okay. Then inferior to the piriformis, the biggest structure you'll see will be the sciatic nerve. Okay, so the sciatic nerve is going to appear on the inferior border of the piriformis. Then you're also going to have the inferior gluteal artery and nerve, which will supply the gluteus maximus. Then you can see the pudendal nerve, and you can also see the nerve to the obturator internus, which will appear on the on the lower border of the piriformis. Then you can see the three muscles, the superior gemellus, in that muscle is the obturator internus, then you have the inferior gemellus, and the last one is the quadratus femoris muscle. So those muscles, they'll form the gluteal region, basically. So the gluteal region is formed by those structures. So you remember why we said you have to introduce the needle into the upper outer quadrant, which is basically that side there. You see, you have less neurovascular structures. So you try to go a bit medial, you can easily damage any of the two. If you go down, yeah, that's where you can even damage like a lot of structures. You can damage the sciatic nerve, you can damage the posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh, you can damage the inferior gluteal artery or nerve, the pudendal nerve, okay, nerve to the obturator internus. All those structures are found on the inferior aspect of the gluteal region. So never introduce an injection there, that's it. So let me talk about the posterior thigh. Then lastly, I'll talk about the popliteal fossa. So when it comes to the posterior thigh, it basically has four muscles. So you have the hamstring muscles, which are made up by the biceps femoris, semitendinosus, and semimembranosus. Then lastly, you're going to have the popliteus muscle. So these muscles that form the posterior thigh region. So biceps femoris. So these are the hamstring muscles, right? So it comes to the biceps femoris just by the name itself, biceps. So it has two heads, okay? So you're going to have the long head, this one, the long head. So the long head is going to originate from the ischiotuberosity. Then you're going to have the short head, which is going to originate from the lateral lip of the linea aspera. Okay, so the two will come together and they will insert on the head of the fibula. You can see the fibula bone, they have the tibia. So on the head of the fibula, that's where it is going to insert. In the innervation, the long head is innervated by the tibial division of the sciatic nerve, and the short head is innervated by the common fibular division of the sciatic nerve. The action, when it comes to the long head, since it is crossing the hip joint, it can bring about extension of the thigh at the hip joint there, because this is the posterior aspect. So when the thigh goes when the thigh goes backward, that's extension. So the long head can bring about extension of the thigh at the hip joint. Then both of them, since they are crossing the knee joint, they'll bring about flexion of the leg. So when the leg goes posteriorly, that's flexion. But when the thigh goes posteriorly, that's extension. So the next one is semitendinosus. So when it comes to semitendinosus, so it originates from the ischiotuberosity. That's the ischiotuberosity. Then it is known semitendinosus because it is almost halfway tendon. As you can see, most of the lower part of the muscle is tendon. So it will originate from the ischiotuberosity, then it will insert on the medial surface of the proximal tibia. So that same medial surface of the proximal tibia has a name, which we already gave it. And that name is the pes anserine. And we even talked about the three muscles that insert on the pes anserine. So you are going to have the gracilis, the sartorius, and the semitendinosus. So these, they'll insert on the proximal medial surface of the tibia. So that part is known as the pes anserine. Okay. The innervation is via the tibial division of the sciatic nerve. Then for the action, it extends the thigh. flexes the leg and medially rotates the leg. Semimembranosus. So it looks like a membrane, actually, as you can see that part. So the semimembranosus originates from the ischial tuberosity as well. Then it inserts on the posterior part of the medial condyle of the tibia. This is the medial condyle of the tibia. That is the lateral condyle of the tibia. So the posterior part of the medial condyle of the tibia, that's where it is going to insert. Okay. Then when it comes to the innervation, it is innervated by the tibial division of the sciatic nerve. For the action, to bring about extension of the thigh. As you can see, it is crossing the hip joint. So it will bring about extension of the thigh. Then here it is crossing the knee joint. So it will bring about flexion of the leg at the knee joint. And it will also bring about medial rotation of the leg. The next muscle. So before we go to the next muscle, the popliteus muscle. So this video or this image just illustrates the hamstring muscles we've talked about. We talked about the biceps femoris here, which has two heads, the long head and the short head. Then on the lateral aspect, talked about the semimembranosus, which is this one. The semimembranosus is this one. Then the semitendinosus, as you can see, most of it is a tendon. And so we talked about those muscles. That muscle is the gracilis, which is found in the medial compartment of the thigh. So those are the hamstring muscles, the biceps femoris, semitendinosus, and semimembranosus, okay? So the popliteus muscle. So when it comes to the popliteus muscle, it is that small muscle found on the floor or on the, on the floor or on the anterior aspect of the popliteal fossa. So the origin, it will originate from the lateral surface of the lateral condyle of the femur. So this is the lateral condyle of the femur. That's where it will originate from. Then it will insert on the posterior surface of the tibia, superior to the soleal line. Okay. So that line you can see there, that's the soleum line, where the soleus muscle originates from. The soleus muscle is found on the posterior aspect of the leg. We'll look at it when we do the leg. So that's the soleal line. Then above the soleal line, going to have the popliteus muscle coming to insert on the posterior tibia. Okay, so innervation is via the tibial nerve. For the action, it unlocks the foot, which is fully extended. It is also a weak flexor of the leg, as you can see, it's crossing the knee joint, so it is a weak flexor. Okay, so basically, those are the muscles of the posterior thigh. So then let me talk about the popliteal fossa now. So when it comes to the popliteal fossa, it is just a diamond-shaped structure, okay? So if it's diamond-shaped, it will appear something like that. So diamond-shaped fossa, like that. So it is going to have boundaries. So you're going to have, so imagine this is the lateral aspect, this is the medial aspect, okay? So this boundary will be known as the superolateral boundary. So this will be the superolateral boundary. And this boundary will be known as the superomedial boundary. And that boundary is going to be known as the inferomedial boundary. And the last one, that one is going to be known as the inferolateral boundary. Okay, so that's a diamond-shaped fossa that has basically four boundaries. It is also going to have the roof, it is going to have the floor. So when it comes to the superolateral boundary, this boundary, it is going to be formed by the biceps femoris muscle, the muscle we were just from talking about, the biceps femoris. So the one which has two heads, the long head and the short head. So it is going to form the superolateral boundary of the popliteal fossa. Then you're going to have the superomedial boundary of the popliteal fossa. The superomedial boundary is going to be formed by the semitendinosus, semimembranosus muscle. So those two muscles, you'll form the superomedial boundary. Then you're going to have the inferomedial. When it comes to the inferomedial boundary, it's going to be formed by the medial head of the gastrocnemius muscle. Okay, then lastly, you're going to have the inferolateral boundary. The inferolateral boundary is going to be formed by the lateral head of the gastrocnemius muscle as well as the plantaris muscle. So these muscles that are forming the inferomedial, inferolateral are coming from the leg. Then you're going to have the flow or the anterior boundary, which is going to be formed by the popliteal surface of the femur as well as the popliteal muscle, the one we're just talking about. Then lastly, you're going to have the posterior boundary or the roof, which is going to be formed by the skin and the popliteal fascia. Popliteal fascia is basically the superficial fascia of the popliteal fossa. Then superior apex. So superior apex is that part there. So we put a different color. So the superior aspect is that part there. That part. Then the inferior apex is going to be that part. Okay. So from the superior apex, you're going to see division of the sciatic nerve. So the sciatic nerve there on the superior aspect is going to divide into the tibial division and the common fibular nerve. So it's going to divide into two nerves on the superior apex of the popliteal fossa. You're going to see all these things. So basically, those are the boundaries of the popliteal fossa. So now, when you go on this image, okay, so this boundary there is the superolateral boundary, which is formed by the biceps femoris muscle. That's the superolateral boundary. Then you're going to have the superomedial boundary formed by the semitendinosus, that one, and the semimembranosus down there. Okay. Then the inferomedial is formed by the medial head of the gastrocnemius muscle, and the inferolateral is formed by the lateral head of the gastrocnemius muscle, as well as the plantaris muscle. That muscle is right there, plantaris muscle. Then on the superior apex, you're going to have the sciatic nerve that is going to divide into the common fibular nerve and into the tibial division. The common fibular nerve is the most injured nerve in the human body because it is very superficial. And it will pass just on the neck of the fibular bone. The most injured nerve in the human body is the common fibular nerve. As you can tell, it's very superficial. Okay. So then I didn't talk about the contents here of the popliteal fossa. So when it comes to the contents of the popliteal fossa, I can talk about them on this image. So the first one you can see is the sciatic nerve and its terminal branches, which is the common fibula and the tibial nerve. You're going to have the medial and lateral sural nerves coming from the common fibular nerve. Okay, so all those. So we show the sciatic nerve and its branches. You're going to have the popliteal vein, and you're also going to have the popliteal artery. So the popliteal vein and the popliteal artery are just continuations of the femoral vein and the femoral artery. So in the femoral vein and the femoral artery pass through the adductor hiatus, which is just an opening within the adductor magnus muscle. So that same adductor hiatus, so the femoral artery and the femoral nerve, the femoral vein passes through it, the name will change to popliteal vein and popliteal artery. And they'll have branches. For example, from the popliteal artery, it has four main branches, which you need to know. And these branches will supply the knee joints, basically. So you're going to have this one there, which is on the medial aspect. It is known as the superior medial genicular artery. Then on the lateral aspect, you're going to have that one. So known as superior lateral genicular artery. Then on the inferior aspect, again, you're going to have two main branches. So that one on the medial aspect will be known as the inferior medial genicular artery. And on the lateral aspect, you're going to have the inferior lateral genicular artery. So these are branches from the popliteal artery. Okay, and basically, they'll supply the knee joint. So they'll go to the anterior aspect and they'll even anastomose. So So even from the vein, you're going to have those. You're going to have the superior medial genicular vein, superior lateral genicular vein, inferior medial genicular vein, and inferior lateral genicular vein. Then you have one important vein that goes to drain into the popliteal vein. That one there, as you can see, okay, the small saphenous vein. So the small saphenous vein goes to drain into the popliteal vein. There at the popliteal fold, as you can see, the small saphenous vein. Then the great saphenous vein goes up above there. Okay. So the great saphenous vein goes to join into the femoral vein through the saphenous opening. Now here you have the small saphenous vein going to drain into the popliteal vein, the popliteal fossa. Okay. So basically, those are the contents and those are the borders of the popliteal fossa, diamond shaped. Know the boundaries. Okay. So basically, that's all for this session. Next session, we'll look at the ligaments of the hip joint, we'll look at the ligaments of the knee joint, we'll look at the lumbosacral plexus. So thank you very much.